بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Our discussion tonight, inshallah ta'ala, which is really appropriate being in this month and in this time wherein there is the school for the revival and the commemoration of the birth of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What we want to speak about, and this is what many people get wrong in the expressions, even though the meaning of what they say might be, or what the intent might be correct, is that what we are speaking about is not the ruling of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but rather the ruling of commemorating and celebrating that birthday. This is the ruling that we are discussing. As for statements such as they don't believe in the Mawlid or the Milad or other statements like this, then it is things which make no sense, as no one can deny the birth of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is the celebration of that birthday and the commemoration thereof which is the matter which is discussed by the ulama, both contemporary as well as the ulama from the time that this practice has been introduced into Islam. So from the time it has been introduced, there has been a lot of discussion regarding it from the ulama of that times, and in every generation until today, it has been an issue of contention between various groups of ulama. So this ihtifal bil Mawlid al-Nabawi, this commemoration and celebration of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should know firstly that it manifests itself from that time until today in various forms. It manifests itself in different ways. And so from those who commemorate it and celebrate it are those who merely say that we take it as an opportunity to read something from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the people and teach them something about his birth sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the great event which occurred with that, that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his coming is one of the greatest blessings Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed on mankind, and there is no one that denies this. So there are those who take it as an opportunity to read the seerah. There are those who manifest it by having circles of what they call remembrance, but remembrance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wherein his characteristics are highlighted, wherein poetry is read in praise of him, and wherein salawat and salam is read upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes in chorus. And sometimes we find that there are those who manifest it with the accompaniment of drums and musical instruments, as well as singing and dancing. There is no doubt, however, that irrespective of how the person manifests it, that this is not something that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his Khulafa al-Rashidun al-Mahdiyun after him did. It is not something that we find in the Quran, in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mentioned with encouragement or with praise, or even mentioned at all. Nor is it something we find in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in terms of encouragement to commemorate it, or to celebrate it, or to highlight its great significance at that particular time and in that particular place. So when these actions are taking place, we have to ask ourselves that before we can give a ruling pertaining to these actions, Before we can give a ruling pertaining to what people are currently reviving and celebrating and commemorating of yani the birthday of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon what do we weigh these actions in order for us to judge it? On what do we weigh it? We know that the sources of the Sharia is only four. It's only four things which make up the sources of the Sharia according to the Usul al-Fiqh. And this is the Quran, the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the consensus, yani complete agreement of the Muslims, and lastly the Qiyas, the analogy which is made upon a previous example and which is yani correct, a correct analogy, not an analogy which is yani incorrect or out of context. So we have to weigh these actions upon those scales. So we have to look at what the people are celebrating and the act of celebration and look whether it is found within the sources of the Sharia. Now as I said, first and foremost, it is not in the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, it is not in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thirdly, it cannot be established from consensus because since it has been practiced, the Muslims have differed regarding it. And because there is no preceding example for the likes of it in the Quran or the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it cannot be established by analogy. It cannot be established by making qiyas, because qiyas does not enter when there is yani text and when we talk about acts which is tawqifiyya, yani which is restricted to the Quran, to what the Sharia has legislated for us. So this was introduced into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there are two statements pertaining to who introduced this act of commemorating or celebrating Miladun Nabi. One of those statements is that it was first done by the Shia al-Fatimiyya, the Fatimid Shias, that they were the first to commemorate the Miladun Nabi. And this was after the praiseworthy generations, yani in the 4th Hijri century. And we know that they are responsible for many innovations that occurred within the Ummah and that took root within those particular, within that particular time period, such as also the innovation of building tombs and erecting tombs over the graves of whom we perceive to be righteous. This was also something introduced by the Fatimid Shi'is. However, other ulama state that the first to publicly commemorate this and call for its commemoration was the King Al-Muzaffar Abu Sa'id Kawkaburi. Al-Muzaffar Abu Sa'id Kawkaburi, who was the king of Erbil in the 6th century Hijri. So in the 6th century Hijri, this particular king, he introduced public commemoration of Miladun Nabi. Now, 6th century Hijri is a long time after the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and after his rightly guided Khulafa. In fact, it is a long time after Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. It is a long time after the Tabi'in and the Atba'ut Tabi'in and after the four Imams and their students. So it was introduced very late into Islam. Very late someone came up with the introduction of this particular ihtifal or commemoration. And this has been stated by Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala in Al-Bidayah wa Al-Nihayah, in his book on history. Al-Bidayah wa Al-Nihayah. Likewise, Ibn Khalikan in his book Wafayatul A'yan, book on the biographies of certain personalities, Islamic personalities, Wafayatul A'yan. Ibn Khalikan, he also mentions that the one who introduced it firstly was Al-Muzaffar Abu Sa'id Kaukaburi. Abu Sa'id Kaukaburi, that he is the one responsible for it. Then Abu Shama, rahimahullah ta'ala, Abu Shama said, وَكَانَ أَوَّلُ مَنْ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ بِالْمُوصِلِ الشيخ Umar ibn Muhammad al-Mullah. Abu Shama says that the first one to do this in al-Mosul was the Shaykh by the name of Umar ibn Muhammad al-Mullah. Umar ibn Muhammad al-Mullah. And he was أَحَدُ الصَّالِحِينَ الْمَشْهُورِينَ. He was one of the known pious people. One of the known righteous people. So following him in this was then Abu Sa'id Kaukaburi. Because he was a righteous man and he practiced this, the king followed his example in this and made it a public commemoration. And likewise anyone else who followed Yani this king and who did it after him, then they all followed Yani, as Abu Shama said, Umar ibn Muhammad al-Mullah. Now, the way in which this was introduced, Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions it in Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. And he says that whoever, or from those who attended the celebration and yani the spread at the king's place, this Abu Sa'id Kaukaburi, then they witnessed that there would be 5,000 sheep heads, you know, or cattle heads, that they considered a delicacy. You know, they ate the head of the cattle and the sheep. So you would find, you know, barbecued 5,000 heads, and you would find 10,000 chickens. 10,000 chickens. And you would find 30,000 plates or platters of sweetmeats. And there was a lot of expenditure and there was a lot of yani wealth being put out and a lot of meals. And also Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions, and he would set aside a sama'an li sufiyyah. He would set aside a time period for the sufiyyah to bring the qasidas and the singing and the poetry. And he himself, Abu Sa'id Kaukaburi, would dance with them. He himself would dance with yani with the Sufiya, who then made the sima, did the singing and the dancing. He himself joined in that particular thing. So we see that there was a lot of expenditure, there was a lot of israf, a lot of extravagance in commemorating this particular thing. Then also Ibn Khalikan, he mentions it, and he says that they would take the cattle and the sheep and all the animals which they would want to slaughter for the celebration, they would take them out to the fields accompanied by music, by beating on the drums, by singing, and by, you know, all this going about until they came to the field where they would then slaughter yani the food or the cattle for the celebration. Subhanallah. And basically this was the way in which Ibn Khaliqan introduced it. So from the outset we can see that either the first to celebrate it was the Fatimid Shias. After them, those who made it a public spectacle and brought this commemoration out to the masses was a king who did not only follow but joined up with the Sufiya in singing and dancing on the occasion of the Miladun Nabi. On both occasions we ask, is this examples worthy of following? Are these examples worthy of following? Are these people that, yani in Islam, these are the type of people that you should follow? You know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders you to keep yourself with, to keep yourself patiently with those who remember Allah. Are these those type of people? The first thing is, up until today, and even in our own context, in our own, in Cape Town here, the debate is still prevalent regarding whether the Shias is Muslim or not, especially the Rafidah. especially those Rafida. Right? So if this debate is ongoing by the Sunni scholars of Cape Town, then why is it that we have blind followed these same individuals regarding whom we doubt the Islam, but we are blind following them for 1,000 years in celebrating the Milad al-Nabi, which they introduced. But we come on the radio and we call to our masajid and we have meetings and we tell the people that these people are astray. These people are astray. They are not upon the Quran, they are not upon the Sunnah, and some of them, they say, they are not even within the fold of Al-Islam, because they commit kufr, which takes you out of the fold of Islam. Yet, they are blind following these same individuals up until this day with the practice of Milad al-Nabi, the practice of Ihtifal, commemorating the Milad al-Nabi. Now, the reasons why we say that Milad al-Nabi, or its commemoration, is haram, it is prohibited in Islam. There are various reasons why we should say that it is haram to commemorate the birth of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first of those reasons is that it is something which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ever commemorated, nor did his rightly guided khulafa, his rightly guided successors Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhum, nor did they celebrate it, nor did the rest of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nor did the tabi'een or the atba'u tabi'een commemorate the birth of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if it was good, would they not have preceded us in that good? Definitely, if it was good, they would have preceded us in that. The fact that they did not do it is a clear proof that it is a bid'atun muhdathatun fil Islam. It is an innovation which was introduced into the deen of Al-Islam. It was introduced in the deen of Al-Islam. And when we accept an innovation introduced by someone else into Islam, then first and foremost we go against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in His Quran, when He said unto us and ordered every Muslim, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء. Follow that which has been sent down to you from your Lord. Follow that which has been sent down to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only two things were sent down to this ummah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the Quran and the Sunnah. And we all know that. It's the only two things which were sent down. This is not found in the Quran and the Sunnah. So we are going against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Allah says, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَا. Do not follow other protectors, patrons, friends or allies besides Him. Besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what was sent down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. And little do you reflect on admonishment. Little do you remember. So, in this, number one, when we celebrate and accept this innovation, and that it is good and that we can celebrate it, we're going against the ayah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Secondly, we're going against what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَيَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Whoever of you live long will see a lot of differences. We'll see a lot of ikhtilaf. He said what? عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءَ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. You should hold on to my sunnah and the sunnah of my rightly guided khulafa after me. So this is not the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nor is it the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it is an innovation, without a doubt. When we accept this innovation, we go against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, أَلْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. And Allah said that this day I have completed your religion for you. And I have perfected my favor upon you. And I am pleased with Islam for you as a religion. Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, based on that ayah, whatever was not deen and part of deen that day, can never be deen today. And Imam Malik said this in his time. He said this in his time. Whatever was not deen that day, the day that the ayah was revealed, cannot be deen today. Yani 100 years later. So what about 600 years later? What about 1400 years later? Someone comes with something today, we say to him, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a verse to the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, today I have completed your religion for you. So the deen was complete 1400 years ago. What is this that you are coming with? So when we accept it, then we say that what Allah has stated in the ayah is not correct. That the deen was not complete and therefore we had to accept this action which was introduced by whoever it was introduced by. We also state by yani lisanul hal, by our actions, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not convey to us all of the deen. That he did not convey to us all of the deen. Because here is something which is good, but which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't teach us. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is no prophet. مَا كَانَ مِن نَبِيٍ. There is no prophet إِلَّا وَكَانَ حَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. Except that it was a duty upon him. أَن يَدُلَّ أُمَّتَهُ عَلَى كُلِّ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُ. That he directs his ummah to every good that he knows for them. It is a haq on every Nabi that he directs his ummah to every good that he knows for them. And that he warns them from every evil that he knows could afflict them. So if we say that this is good, but the Prophet ﷺ did not do it, then we are saying that he did not direct us to every good. Because here is some good which he did not direct us to. So either way, all of that which we mentioned, yani it is a proof that this action, this commemoration is an innovation, and therefore it is haram. Because every innovation is haram. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَشَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. And he said, the worst of things are novelties in the religion. And every such novelty is an innovation. And every innovation is misguidance. And every misguidance is in the hellfire. So that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made clear that every innovation is haram. So this is the first reason why it is not permissible to commemorate or celebrate the birth of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second reason that we should not celebrate it and why it is haram is that it is tashabbuh bin Nasara. It is imitating the Nasara. الذين يحتفلون بمولد عيسى بن مريم عليه الصلاة والسلام. It is imitating the Nasara who celebrate and commemorate the birth of Nabi Isa, the son of Maryam, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And imitating them is haram. Imitating them is haram. As he صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever imitates a people is from them. Whoever imitates a people is from them. As reported by Imam Ahmad and other than him. Likewise, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered with even differing from the mushrikeen. He said, خَالِفُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Be different. Differ with the mushrikeen, differ with those who make shirk. Differ or be different to those who make shirk, as reported by Imam Muslim in his Sahih. So in imitating them, we are going against yani a severe warning of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we are doing exactly what the Nasara did يعني regarding Nabi Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام to the extent that they ended up worshipping Nabi Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام. So it starts with something small. As Imam Barbahari رحمه الله تعالى says, إياكم وصغار المحدثات. Beware of the small innovations. Beware of the small innovations. فإنه تعود حتى تصير كبارا. Because it continues, it comes back and comes around until it becomes big. So it starts small, but it keeps changing and growing until it becomes very, very big. So this is something that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned. At-tashabbu bin-nasara, imitating the Nasara. Likewise, imitating the Yahud or imitating the Mushrikeen is not permissible in al-Islam. Now, how did the Muslims go as far as this imitation? They started by merely, like we said, some people started by commemorating maybe, and we're not talking about those who initiated it, but those who commemorated it by reading the Seerah. Others took it further and they hymned the praises of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Others took it a step further. They saw that the Nasara, you know, the Nasara have these, what they call Christmas trees. And that has become something that represents them and represents that ikhtifal, that commemoration, the Christmas commemoration. The Muslims, because Medina was known for its what? Palms. The date palms. Right? The date palms. So they enter into the masajid these date palm leaves at the time of Miladun Nabi. And this has become yani a sign affiliated and associated with the time of Miladun Nabi. Just like the Christmas tree is associated with the time of Miladu Isa, with the Nasara. So they've gone to that extent. The Nasara went a step further before us, before the Muslims, by also decorating their places at the time of Miladu Isa. The time when they celebrate the birth of Nabi Isa, they put trimmings in the houses and they put lights on those trees. The Muslims have imitated them even in this, that they put up the very same trimmings at the time of Ihtifal bin Mawlid al-Nabawi. They put up the very same, I call it Christmas trimmings. They put up these Christmas trimmings in the masajid, in the house of Allah. You find that lights is being placed all over the place. Electricity bill, subhanallah, skyrockets at the time of Milad al-Nabi. For no reason, except decorating the mosques for Miladun Nabi. Now, is this something that the Sharia has come to us with at any time? No. The Sharia has come to us warning us from decorating the mosque and beautifying the mosques and making it things to boast of. Sharia has warned us about that. But we have followed the Nasara in this. The Muslims followed them even to their trimmings. Recently, I don't know how, it might be older than what I perceive it to be, but for myself, just last year was the first time that I ever heard of Muslims also now exchanging gifts at the time of Miladun Nabi. People giving presents to one another at the time of Miladun Nabi. So what is it becoming? It's becoming Christmas. It's becoming exactly the same like the Yahud celebrate, or like the Nasara celebrate, the commemoration of the birth of Nabi Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. The third reason why it is haram and prohibited is that it is a means which leads to al-ghulu fi al-deen wa fi haqq al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It leads towards exaggerating in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and exaggerating specifically regarding the haqq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his status. That this ihtifal, it leads to this exaggeration in praise of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like in this qasaid, in this qasidas which they read, when they say, and from your knowledge is what? Amongst us is a prophet who knows the unseen. Or from your knowledge is the knowledge of the lawh and the pen. Or from your kindness is the giving of the heavens and the earth. Yani from your kindness, from your generosity, the Prophet ﷺ is the heavens and the earth. Did he ﷺ create the heavens and the earth? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth. But this is the exaggeration which occurs when people celebrate this ihtifal, when they hold this ihtifal in Mawlid al-Nabawi, and they become emotional. It becomes an emotional thing. And because of emotions not being guided by Sharia, you know, it leads to exaggeration and excessive praise of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, who is it that warned us and prohibited us from exaggerating in praising him sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It is he himself. It is the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself who said unto us, as comes in the hadith, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى عيسى بن مريم إنما أنا عبد فقولوا عبد الله ورسوله. He said, do not elevate me as the Nasara elevated Isa the son of Mary. I am only a slave. So say, the slave of Allah and his messenger. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prohibited us from elevating him, from praising him excessively, yani beyond the station which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afforded unto him. And this hadith is recorded by Bukhari. However, we have opposed his order. We have opposed the order of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we have exaggerated in praise of him, specifically in this time of, yani, that the ihtifal bi Mawlid al-Nabawi takes place. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he warned from that, and he also said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْغُلُوْ. Beware of exaggeration. فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ الْغُلُوْ. Because it is nothing but exaggeration that destroyed those before you. This hadith is reported by Al-Nasa'i and authenticated by Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. That he said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْغُلُوْ. Beware of exaggeration, for what destroyed those before you was exaggeration. They exaggerated in praise of Nabi Isa, they were destroyed. When the Yahud exaggerated in praise of Uzair, they called him the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they were destroyed. So what destroyed all those before was the exaggeration, that they elevated people beyond the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afforded unto him. Insha'Allah, when we come back, we will continue. There are more reasons, there are more ilal pertaining to why this ihtifal is not permissible in Islam. We will do that when we return after Salah.
Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa ta'ala.
The fourth reason why this ihtifal bil Mawlid al-Nabawi is prohibited, and yani why we should not encourage it, or rather why we should prevent people from it, is that which is associated with it and accompanies it of wasting of wealth, of time, and of resources. That with these commemorations, it is not strange to find that the wealth of the Muslims is being collected to squander on the commemoration and the food that is to be made and served, and for the trimmings that is to be placed in the masajid, and for the lights that is to be yani switched on, and for which electricity is needed. So it is not strange to find masajid calling upon the Muslim community and the musallis of his masajid to gather and bring their funds and to, you know, contribute towards these celebrations which are taking place in the masajid. And there is no absolute, or there is no direct benefit from this wealth, rather it is wasting. Likewise with the food, that food are being made on such a scale that it can't all be finished, and you'll find such a lot of wasting at various venues and these masajid and these places where the celebrations are taking place. Why is this haram? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا. That eat and drink and do not be wasteful and extravagant. Do not be wasteful and extravagant. Two aspects. Israf. Israf is either in wasting that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. Yani, so you have wealth Allah has given you. You're using your wealth for nonsense. You buy food or you make food and the food is being wasted. Or it is being given to people who have food at home. No, they collect money, they make all these pots of food, and those who attend these commemorations are normally people who have food at home. And they think that with doing this they are giving charity. So they are in reality wasting their wealth, wasting this food, also wasting the resources. Yani the masjid wealth, the Baytul Mal, which is collected at the masjid and which should serve yani the masjid and the community, is sometimes used for these commemorations. Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا. Do not be wasteful and extravagant. So extravagance in itself is blameworthy, and wasting in itself is also blameworthy. So both of this you'll find accompanying this ihtifal bil Mawlid al-Nabawi, this commemorations of the prophetic birthday. So this is also then one of the reasons why it is haram. Another reason why it is haram, why it is prohibited, is that this ihtifal bil Mawlid, it yani yaftahu baban لإذداح بداع أخرى. It opens a doorway for other innovations as well. Agreeing and accepting this innovation opens the doorway for other innovations to be introduced as well. Because if you accept one, what's the difference between the one and the other? See, in all bid'ah, it will be accepted. And likewise, bid'ah is introduced even along with the ihtifal. The ihtifal itself is a bid'ah, but then more bid'ah is introduced with that. Right? Like the singing of qasa'id, which is shirkiyah, the singing of these this poems and this qasidas, these songs, which yani consist of shirkiyat, of aspects of polytheism, aspects of giving the rights of Allah to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, aspects of false belief, like believing that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is hadir and nadir, that he is present and watching, yani everywhere, present and watching everywhere. When they celebrate Milad al-Nabi all over the world, in every place there's thousands of commemorations. Maybe in the world is millions, right? So all these people, when they say Marhaban Jadd al-Husayni, welcome O grandfather of Hussein, this is accompanied with a belief, and it was founded on the belief that you should stand when saying this out of honor for the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you're standing in order to welcome the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to this gathering, to this hadra. Right? So this is a belief that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam is omnipresent. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam is omnipresent. Also that he's omniscient. Yani that he is omniscient, he knows, because how does he get to all these mawlids? So he knows everything that is happening. He knows where every milad celebration is taking place. Also he sees everything, because he's everywhere. And he hears everything. Subhanallah. So this is giving what is the haqq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it opens the doors not only for bid'ah but for shirk. Opens the doors not only for bid'ah but for shirk. It is also known in the Sharia that that which leads to haram becomes haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تقربوا زنا. Do not come near unto zina. Do not approach it. Do not do anything which could lead unto it. And from that, the asl is derived, the foundation of fiqh in the Sharia is derived, that whatever can lead to that which is haram becomes haram. Based on the ayah, ikhtilat becomes haram. Unrestricted free mixing. No, without mahram. This becomes haram. Why? Because it can lead unto zina. Therefore Allah says, don't come close to zina. Yani don't do anything that can lead unto it. So if miladun, if the ikhtifal bil mawlid nabawi leads to shirk, leads to bid'ah, right, then it in itself becomes haram due to what it leads to. Due to what it leads to, it becomes haram. So the door must be closed, and that celebration, yani it should be, and it is, in the Sharia prohibited, but it should be prohibited by the people of knowledge and by those who care for the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the people should be encouraged to learn the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that won't give them time to yani busy themselves with innovations and things which were introduced to the deen which is not from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the people who hold on to these innovations and who protect it and call to it and defend it, they have certain doubts that they raise regarding it. They have certain reasons that they forward as yani justification for celebrating the Miladun Nabi. One such reason is that it is ta'zim of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is glorification or magnifying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that this is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do. Allah has ordered us yani to give the haqq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to recognize his status. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order us to do it like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order us with introducing innovations into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to yani recognize the status of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us the basis on which to magnify the status of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us with following him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us with loving him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us with obeying him, taking his example, taking his guidance and implementing it. And this in itself is magnifying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because when you set out someone as your ultimate example, it shows your high esteem you hold for that individual. This is why it is not permissible to follow anyone else exclusively in everything he says other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because this is giving that person more prestige than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, giving him precedence over the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, Allah has legislated how ta'zim of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam must be shown. And it is not by introducing things which the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against, prohibited, and which is against the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that which Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered us with. Another justification or reason that they give for doing this is that they say it is the amal of kathir min al-nas, it is the action of many of the people in many lands. In other words, it's the action of the majority. It's the action of the majority. The majority of people are doing it. You know, so it's only some people that have a problem with it. First and foremost, never in the Sharia is the action of the majority a hujjah, a proof. Nowhere in the Quran or in the Sunnah does Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam order us with following the majority. Rather, we find many times it is the opposite. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّوكَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you obey the majority of those on the earth, that would take you away from the path of Allah. If you follow the majority of those on the earth, they would misguide you away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how is the majority approved?
Another thing they say is, every night the ummah or the scholars on batil.
That is a proof against them. That is a proof against them. They say from this, they say, so see, most of the ulama, they have agreed with this. Most of the people have accepted this. So this then, the acceptance and the coming together on this is a proof that it is correct. Why? Because of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not unite the ummah upon misguidance. Now he asked them, the ummah when they were united in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the only time when this ummah was absolutely united. Right? The time of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sahaba was the only time that this ummah was absolutely united. Now, after that time, first and foremost, when this action was introduced, was it within the time that this ummah was united as one body, or within the time that the ummah had become split into factions? Absolutely. It was within the time that the ummah already became split into factions. Those who introduced it were at loggerheads with the rest of the ummah. The Shia who first practiced it, they were enemies to the Ahlul Sunnah and the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, who were united upon not practicing it. So the proof that they mention that Allah will not unite the ummah upon misguidance is a proof against them. So when the ummah was united upon not practicing it, then it is guidance to not practice it. Because when they practiced it, the ummah was never ever united upon practicing it. Not one consensus is found, because it's impossible. Consensus very rarely takes place after the time of Rasul Sallallahu and his companions. After that, there's almost always difference. There's almost always difference. And with very few masail do we find after that there is yani total consensus. So consensus is only when no scholars disagree. No scholars disagree. However, when we look at this, in the time that it was introduced, the ulama disagreed with it. The ulama spoke against it. Who introduced it? A king. Who made it a public commemoration? A king. How did he get the people to join in the celebration? With extravagance. 5,000 sheep or cattle heads, 30,000 plates of sweetmeats, all the best. You know, like the Mehram. Like today the people, you get them to come by saying there's going to be free meal served. Mm-hmm. See, they come. So there was never consensus upon it. Never. Whoever quotes it is lying. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala speaks against it. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala speaks against it. Ibn Kathir speaks against it. Those who mentioned the first that practice it. Imam Dhahabi. All the ulama from the time it was commemorated until today speak against it. Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala has a specific treatise on it. Sheikh Muhammad bin Ibrahim al-Sheikh has a specific treatise on it. And likewise other than them. So never has the ulama stopped refuting it. So where is the consensus? Where is the agreement? There's no agreement. There's no consensus. You will find that the true ulama, the ulama of sunnah, those who hold on to the sunnah and who teach the sunnah and who establish and revive the sunnah, you will find all those ulama agreed on warning against it, on prohibiting it. And you will find the ulama of bid'ah. There's no other way to say it. The scholars of innovation, those who not only practice innovation by themselves, but who want to revive it, want to defend it, want to call people to it, you will find them to be the ones who are agreed on it. Then you must check the difference of yani the scholarship of the one party and the other party. You see, there's a huge difference between the scholars of the one group and the other group of scholars. So never has there been agreement on celebrating the Milad al-Nabi. Since it entered Islam, it has been an issue of contention. Likewise is every bidah. Every innovation, when it enters into Islam, it becomes an issue of contention. It becomes an issue of difference. It becomes an issue over which the Muslims fight. Why? Because it is something that is brought into the deen of Allah. It can't unite us. It can't unite us. Only the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was brought to us by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only that can unite us. Anything else, it will only split us. You know, and this is the same that we see with the ikhtifad bi milad al-Nabi. They also say that in this there is reviving of the mention of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this also we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us, yani, to learn from the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to mention him a lot, to mention him. And this reminder of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is repeated for every Muslim who holds on to his deen every day, many times a day, throughout his year. Not once a year, or 1 month of the year, or the 12th of Rabiul Awwal, even though they cannot establish whether that was actually the date of the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the ulama differ on it, right? Rather, the Muslim remembers Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam every day. When the Mu'adhin makes the call, and he says, "Wa ashadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." The Muslim remembers Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever he mentions him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he, as a Muslim, says his shahada after making wudu, he remembers him. Whenever he sits in salah and he says assalamu ala nabi, you know, puts peace on and salutation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the salat al-ibrahimiyah he says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, even then he remembers the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout his day, every day. In following the sunnah, every sunnah he does, he remembers the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who legislated that sunnah for him. So you don't need this once a year commemoration to remember the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, that would be a person who is very negligent of the remembrance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has to wait for a specific time every year to remember the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No, we must remember him every day. No, we remember him every day because we follow his sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another doubt that they have regarding this, they say it is a bid'atun hasana. It is a good bid'ah. It's a good bid'ah. We say, you say this. We say, you say this. We say, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, inna kulla muhdathatin bid'ah, wa kulla bid'atin dalalah. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, indeed, every innovation is misguidance, and every misguidance is a bid'ah. Every novelty is innovation, and every innovation is misguidance. And every misguidance is in the Al-Fayyid. So, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not mention any good bid'ah. No good bid'ah. And when you say this, they refer to ahadith such as, Man sanna fil islami sunnatan hasana. Whoever introduces a good way in Islam, a good sunnah, a good sunnah. Now the first thing is, that the context of the hadith, they don't tell you. They just quote the hadith. So you see, if you introduce a good way in Islam, you'll get its reward and the reward of anyone who acts on it. What is the context of the hadith? A tribe embraced Islam and they were extremely poor. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, Tasaddaqu alayhim. Give charity unto them. And then one Sahabi went home and he came back with so much charity that he could barely carry it. He couldn't even carry it. And upon seeing this, the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Man sanna fil islami sunnatan hasana. Whoever brings a good way in Islam, A good way in Islam, the context shows us. A good way of fulfilling something legislated in Islam. He is fulfilling what? Sadaqah. An order that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered him with. Give sadaqah. But he's excelling in it. You know, so he gives as much as he can carry. To the extent that he almost can't carry it. And the Nabi says this, Man sanna fil Islam sunnatan hasana. On this, other Sahaba followed his example. By giving a lot of charity. See, this was the encouragement of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did the Sahabi do something new? No. It was already legislated, it was ordered by the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right. So it is not a bid'ah. If they say yes, but when Umar introduced the Taraweeh by one imam, he said that this is a ma ahsan hadhihi al-bid'ah. How great is this bid'ah? How good is this bid'ah? You say, did Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, did he introduce Taraweeh? Did he introduce Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan? Or did Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pray it with his companions? Haqq is Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated it. He prayed it with his companions. Right. So when Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, this is a bid'ah, what is he referring to? Bid'atul lughawiyah. A bid'ah in the language. Something that is revived. The Arabic language. Not istilahi. Not shari. Because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did the act. Sahaba did it with him, so how can it be a new thing? How can it be an innovation that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu came with? Right. So this is like the clutching at straws. They use the hadith Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when asked about his fasting on Monday. He said it's the day I was born. So if we all commemorate it in a different way, you say no, then you are making a bid'ah. What Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, he fasted, it is ibadah. Fasting is worship. It is ibadah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it. You, instead of fasting, you are celebrating. You are feasting. You are having a party, you are singing and dancing. You know, so it's the opposite of what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. So, first and foremost, there is no bid'atun hasana. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kullu bid'atun dalala. Every bid'ah is misguidance. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew Arabic better than anyone who came after him. Knew the language of the revelation better than anyone who came after him or anyone who lived in his time. He knew the language of the wahi better than everyone else. The other thing is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad. Whoever introduces something into this affairs of ours which is not from it, and into this deen of ours which is not from it, it is rejected. He did not exclude anything. He said, whoever introduces anything into this deen of ours, it is rejected. And nothing can be introduced into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, it is not bid'atun hasana, every bid'ah is dalala. Who said so? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said so. They say in this, there is showing of love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, but we're showing our love for the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated that we love Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But loving him sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not manifested in doing what he prohibited. Can you imagine that you love someone so much so that everything he told you not to do, you do. And you say you do it because you love him. Subhanallah. You know, this person won't like you very much. Isn't it? He won't like you very much. Everything you know he dislikes, you do. And then when somebody says to you, you know this brother doesn't like you, but I love him and that's why I do it. Subhanallah. Right. So this is the same thing. They say in ihtifal that this commemoration is out of love for the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says first and foremost, if you love Allah, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. If you love Allah, follow me. Say to them, if you love Allah, follow me. So you must follow the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you do not have iman until I am more beloved to you than your children, your parents and all the people. You do not have true iman until you love me more than everyone, even yourself. So this is legislated. We must love him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much, even more than ourselves. But how do we manifest that love? We manifest it by following him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the greatest extent. Everything he did, we love him so much that we strive to do whatever he did. Everything he ordered, we strive to fulfill whatever he ordered. Everything he prohibited, we stay away from what he prohibited. Everything we knew we know he disliked, we don't want to do something that he disliked. That is love for the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not doing everything opposite to what he said and claiming that we love him. And how is that love manifested if it's only once a year? You only love him Rabi'ul Awwal, the rest of the year you forget about him. And if you really loved him, you would obey him. You would follow his sunnah. Like it is said, لو كان حبك صادقا لأطعته إن المحب لمن يحب مطيع. If your love for him was true, you would have obeyed him. For verily, the lover is obedient to the one that he loves. You love someone, you obey that person. If you love someone, you don't want to upset that person. So how can your love be true when you do everything that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not want you to do? You elevate him beyond what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered you with. He said, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى عيسى بن مريم. Don't raise me like the Nasara raised عيسى بن مريم. Say the slave of Allah and his messenger. You go beyond that. What do you say? Out of love for him. So you disobey him out of love for him. SubhanAllah. It can't be right. You introduce into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited. He prohibited that anyone introduces anything into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you do it and you say you love him. You call people to practice that which is not from his sunnah, whilst fighting his sunnah and calling them to oppose his sunnah, which is authentically established from him. And you say you do it because you love him. How on earth can that be love? How is that love of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That love is hypocrisy. That love is hypocrisy. It's not true. It is just a statement of the tongue. It's a statement of the tongue aiming to justify the wrongs that we are doing. No, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is free of all those things which the people are practicing and claiming that they are doing it out of love for him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Love for him is shown in obedience to him, in following his sunnah, in following what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated, and not in introducing into the deen that which is not part of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another justification they give, they say it is an opportunity to bring the people to the masjid and teach them some of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to wait for once a year to teach the people some of the seerah of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You don't have Jumu'ah every Friday to teach them about the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The mosque is not open for the imams to teach the people the sunnah and the seerah of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have to wait for Rabi'ul Awwal every year and then seek one night of Rabi'ul Awwal to teach him the seerah and then forget about him for the rest of the year. SubhanAllah. If it was true that they wanted to teach the people the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you would find masajid wherein the seerah is being taught. You find masajid in which they teach and give lectures on the life of personalities, on the life of individuals who lived in recent times, on the life of sheikhs, of tariqas, on the lives of leaders of political movements. Lectures are given regarding the lives of these individuals. Why Do we have to wait once a year to teach the people the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It is because of doing this, it is because of establishing Islam upon what we call this festivities and commemorations, that the masajid are empty. It's because of that. It's because people can come big nights. They can come to big nights. They don't have to come every day to the masjid. They don't have to come and make salah 5 times a day. They can come big nights. So they'll come for Miladun Nabi. And they will come for Laylatul Bara, which they claim. And they will come maybe the 27th night of Ramadan. Maybe. Because they think that night is Laylatul Qadr, definitely. Because the Imam sometimes are saying it is that night, and the calendars are already marked, the 27th night. So they forget, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, seek it in the last 10 nights. So they come the 27th night. What other nights do they come for? The night of Isra and Miraj, they come and commemorate that night. And the rest of the time, the masajid are empty. Now, we say stop these commemorations and teach the people the seerah every night. If you want to teach them the seerah, teach them every night between Maghrib and Isha. Or give one night of the week for seerah. Give one night of the week for seerah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we love him so much, you know, shouldn't we be interested in learning who he was? Learning his life, what he went through, what he sacrificed in order to convey this deen as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed unto him. So this claim that it is an opportunity to teach the people the seerah is an empty claim, because you have that opportunity every day. Masajid are not bound by a constitution that does not allow them to teach the seerah except in Rabiul Awal. See, masajid can teach the seerah every day. So this is another empty claim which is clutching at straws. Clutching at straws. They don't have anything, so they get the likes of this particular things. Another of their claims, it is that it is mere dhikrullah. It is merely remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is merely remembrance. We're just coming to the masjid and making dhikrullah. You know? The question is, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who legislated for us to make dhikr, say we must come to the masjid on the 12th of Rabiul Awal to come and make it? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order us with this specific dhikrullah, which comes once a year, that we should make this dhikrullah? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to remember Allah abundantly, every day, morning and evening, yani day and night. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us the adhkar that we say throughout the day and throughout the night. For everything we do, there is dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For everything we do. For waking up, for going into the toilet, subhanAllah, for when we take the wudu, when we are finished, when we go to the masjid, when we wake up at night, when we stir in our sleep, dhikrullah is legislated by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, why do we have to come once a year to the masjid for dhikrullah? No, why even do we have to come once a week? For dhikrullah. Dhikrullah is every day, throughout the day. That is the dhikr which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of in the Quran. That is the dhikr Allah speaks of. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ تَضُرَّعًا وَخِيفَةً وَدُونَ الْجَهْرِ مِنَ الْقَوْلِ فِي الْغُدُوِ وَالْأَصَالِ وَلَا تَكُمْ مِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and remember your Lord by yourself. Remember your Lord by yourself. Some of the ulama say, within yourself. Some say, yani softly. Tadurra'an, with humility and awe, wa khifatan, and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa dun al jahri min al qawl, and without loud words. In the morning and in the evening, and don't be of those who are neglectful. Don't be of those who are neglectful, like those who want to make dhikr once a year. Don't be like those. Make dhikr every day, day and night. Day and night. This is the dhikr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated. Not that we come together once a year, or once a week, whatever the case may be, and say that this is dhikrullah. And we make our own dhikrullah, we write our own salawat, we write our own qasaid, we write our own praises, which many times, like I say, contain bid'ah and shirk and dua to the Prophet ﷺ, seeking madad from the Prophet ﷺ, making shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we say this is dhikrullah. A'udhu billah. It's not dhikrullah, this is, subhanallah, this is taking away the haqq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is transgression in the haqq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is another of the futile arguments that they bring for the commemoration of Miladun Nabi. Then also, lastly, inshaAllah ta'ala, we see that this dhikr, this ihtifal, this commemoration of Miladun Nabi has also opened up other commemorations. And you find that the Ummah now, they are caught up in celebrating Milad, celebrating births and celebrating deaths to such an extent that the whole deen has become celebrations of births and deaths. The whole deen has become celebration of birth and death. They did not stop with the birth of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They also celebrate now the ihtifal of the Mawlid of Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani. They celebrate the ihtifal of the Mawlid of Badawi. They celebrate the ihtifal of the Mawlid of Mu'inuddin Chisti. They celebrate the ihtifal of the Milad of the sheikhs of all the various tariqas. And then they also commemorate their deaths. So what happens now? It is one celebration to the next celebration. One commemoration to the next commemoration. One urs to the next urs. So the deen becomes what? It becomes, subhanallah, dancing and singing and just wasting of time and resources, subhanallah, which should be spent in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is spent upon bid'ah and khurafat and shirkiyat. And the people are losing the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are oblivious to it. They are not being taught it by the same individuals who defend the ihtifal of the Miladun Nabi. They defend the celebration of the Milad, but they fight the sunnah of the same Nabi. They fight the sunnah. They fight his aqidah. They fight the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They fight the call to that tawheed. They fight the call to reviving his sunnah. And they celebrate Miladun Nabi. Subhanallah, how confused can you be? You celebrate his birth supposedly out of love, but you reject his sunnah. You don't want to follow the call which he strove his whole life for, the call of Tawheed. You call it now Wahhabiyya, Salafiyya, Mutashaddida, extremism, whatever they want to call it. Whatever the names they give to the call to Tawheed. And then they forget that this is the Tawheed which was brought by the same Nabi whose birthday they are celebrating. And who they are calling for celebrating his birth out of love. Now where is establishing his deen out of love? Where is following his sunnah out of love? Where is being obedient to him out of love? So like I say, how confused can you be? If you don't have ikhlas, if you don't have sincerity in seeking the haqq and in following the haqq, then shaitan will deviate you very easily. Shaitan deviates you very easily and you become blind to the misguidance that he gets you on. You become blind to it. So it seems to you that that is guidance, whereas guidance is clear in front of your face but you don't see it. Imagine the Quran is there. The sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there, and we turn away from it and we want to follow things which has no basis in the Sharia. You know? So, inshaAllah, with those with these few words that we have imparted, we hope that we have shed some light on the ruling of this ihtifal, this commemoration of the birthday of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We hope that it has become clear to everyone why the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah throughout time have said not to celebrate this. Why also the ulama of Bid'ah has been celebrating it. We hope we clarified with those doubts that you mentioned that they say. And we hope that we gave sufficient answers to that. And in ending we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. That oh Allah, show us the truth for truth. Show us the truth for what it is and grant us to follow it. And show us the batil for what it is and grant us the ability to abstain from it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and not deviate our hearts after He has guided us. And may He grant us rahmah from Himself. Indeed, He is the bestower. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put peace, salutations and blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his family and friends. Subhana rabbina rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Barakallahu feekum.
We have also said
in the statement where he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that indeed وَشَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. The worst of the fears is novelties in the deen, and every such novelty is an innovation. Every innovation is misguidance, and every misguidance is in the hellfire. Some of the people of innovation, they have looked at this hadith and they've come up with an amazing conclusion. They said, you see, the Nabi said, the bid'ah is in the hellfire, not the person. They said, wallahi, I've heard this. They say the bid'ah is in the hellfire, not the person. Can you imagine that the bid'ah is in the hellfire by itself? Why is it a bid'ah? Somebody did it. Otherwise it would not be a bid'ah. So when he says that the innovation is in the hellfire, some of the ulama that actually mentioned in the books of the sunnah that al-bid'ah wa ahluha fi an-nar. The bid'ah and its people is in the hellfire. Yani those who did it, those who called to it, those who defended it, those who acted upon it. Those are the people, yani, that have been promised the hellfire due to the innovation. They have been promised the hellfire due to the innovation as punishment. We are not saying with this that they are kafir. We're not saying they are disbelievers. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned people that will enter into hellfire but will be taken out and enter into Jannah. Right? So bid'ah is one of those actions which will have you first being purified in Jahannam before entering into the Jannah. Now who of us wants to take that bayah? No one wants to take that route. You know, we're asking Allah, Allahumma ajirna min al-nar. Oh Allah, save us from the hellfire. You say, no, it's alright. You know, this is like the Yahud's mentality. You know? وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَنَا النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودًا. They say that the fire won't touch us except for a couple of days. You know, as if it is okay. You know, can we enter for a couple of days? We're going to come out eventually. You know, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. A Muslim, he fears hellfire. You know, ask Allah to save him from it. So, just like they use the same philosophy, where they got it from, Allah A'lam. I don't want to say like Nazim Haqqani, maybe some, you know, someone from Mars or Jupiter or Saturn gave the fatwa. You know, this is the fatwa of the Najbandis given from someone from Mars, Jupiter or Saturn. Huh? Yeah, the grandchild of the Najbandis gets a fatwa. From Mars, Jupiter or Saturn? Huh? Who's staying there? Allah A'lam. Nevertheless, I don't know where they got it from. But they say this is the same for the thawb which is hanging on the floor. Sit top of the floor. Nabi SAW said, "Ma ashfala min al-ka'bayn fa fi an-nar." What is below the ankles is in the hellfire. They said this is referring to the garment, not the person. So Allah is going to resurrect your top yawm al-qiyamah. Huh? Allah is going to resurrect. I don't know where people come with these things. Allah is going to resurrect your top, and the top is going to be in hellfire. It's not you. It's not you that's going to be punished. Right? I don't know where they get that from. It's the same way. It's the person who is doing it who is being threatened with hell. The person is being threatened with punishment. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from those things. Anything else?
I sort of also add to what the sister said that without the people who he shared, there won't be no bid'ah anyway.
So therefore the punishment is stated unto them. We'll see another hadith. You remind me another hadith. The people who innovated. When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is gathered with his ummah at the Hawd. When he's gathered with his ummah at the pond, yawm al-qiyamah, before they enter into Jannah. Right? He says, فَيُؤْخَذْ مِنْ أُمَّتِي يعني بالشمال. Some of them will be taken away to the left. Some of them will be taken away to the left. يعني the angels will drive them away. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, I will say, أُمَّتِي أُمَّتِي. I will say, my ummah. They are from my ummah. And it will be said, يَا مُحَمَّدْ إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُ بَعْدَكَ. Oh Muhammad, you don't know what they innovated after you. You don't know what they innovated after you. So, if they are being driven away from the pond, where are they being driven to? To the left side. There's people on the right and there's people on the left. What is the left? Exactly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear. Ashab al-yameen and ashab al-shimal. So, if they're driven to the left, that is Jahannam. So, where they get this from, that it is the innovation and not the person? Allah A'lam, this is the greatest. I've never seen people derive ahkam like this.
Sheikh, you can also say, even though we must love the Prophet, it's also being taught by him as well.
Nice.
Because that's where the confusion comes in. People say, you know, we're doing this because we mentioned the honorable name of the Prophet.
It becomes like a smokescreen. And in reality, they are not taking lesson from the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah. You know, they're not taking from what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated. And rather, this statement is being used. It is being used to deceive the masses. You know, you must come because it is love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I tell them the Prophet never did it. Tell them the Prophet said that every innovation is misguidance. Tell them that no imams ever did it. This is one thing I'm amazed by. When it comes to issues of fiqh, when it comes to issues in which ijtihad is allowed, ijtihad is allowed in fiqh, isn't it? Research. It must be continuous until qiyamah. This ummah is going to continuously face new problems. So, ijtihad must continue. When it comes to issues of fiqh, they say, you must make taqlid, it is wajib. It is wajib. You must blind follow one of the four imams. Now it comes to issues of aqidah, in which it is wajib to blind follow the Quran and the Sunnah. They say, no, we make ijtihad. We make ijtihad. This is a bid'atun hasana. You see, the ulama said this is a bid'atun hasana. It's not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah, the four imams didn't do it. Why don't you make taqlid now? You say Imam Shafi never ever did it. Why don't you follow Imam Shafi? Why don't you blind follow now? Right? Because now it doesn't suit the desires. Now it doesn't suit the other deviant part of my methodology, which is the Sufi part. Because when it comes to the Sufi part, we know that the imams is on one side, like the four imams, they are on one side, and the students and the contemporaries who were with them, and the Sufis is on the other side. See, so now, when it comes to that issues, I'm with the other side. You see, here where it is supposed to be, where it is more okay, it is more emphasized that I should follow the imams, because they were united in issues of aqidah. Now I want to make ijtihad and follow someone else and say, you know, I've made ijtihad, this is correct, we can do this. Yusuf Qardawi is a great faqih. You see, he says, okay, made ijtihad in the mas'ala. A'udhu billah. Now make taqleed now. Because you say it's wajib to make taqleed. You see? A'udhu billah. Now they don't make taqleed. So it's playing with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is deceiving the Muslims. You find a person saying he's a alim, and when you ask him a question, then he says he's a muqallid. He's a blind follower. Right? And then you come to an issue of aqidah, you say, no, it's a masalatul ijtihadiyah. It's a masala in which they can be ijtihad. You know, this type of claim is a lack of sincerity. That is all it is, a lack of sincerity. May Allah protect us from that and grant us sincerity. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.